Welcome back to the sixth in our series on vitamins. And in this section, I'm going to be covering all of the B vitamins. So this section is going to be a little bit longer. And remember, these are water-soluble vitamins. We just covered vitamin C, which is also a water-soluble vitamin. A, D, E, and K are our fat-soluble vitamins. The reason I'm going to talk about all the B vitamins together is they work together, and they're in general, part of coenzymes and involved in energy metabolism. And that's why we think of course, when you go and you see supplementations or supplements, you see a complex B or B vitamin complex, because the B vitamins really do work together. And that's how I'd like you to think of them. There are a couple of B vitamins that I'm going to highlight and point out for you in particular, because some are involved in new cell synthesis, which is kind of an important separate action of these B vitamins. Now, I said that they are part of coenzymes. You might be thinking, well, what is a coenzyme? Let's start with an enzyme. An enzyme is essentially it's a protein, but it's going to help speed a reaction. We think of it as a catalyst. And if we took these two compounds here, and they're separate individual compounds, but the enzyme is going to convert them into a single compound. And this compound might have a unique function that's necessary. But the enzyme can't do this without the coenzyme. And these B vitamins are necessary for these coenzymes to work, or they will function as the coenzyme. And in general, that's how I want you to think about these B vitamins, as working together, as being coenzymes, and involved in energy metabolism. Now, what's energy metabolism? You're thinking, well, what does that mean? We take in food and break it down and absorb it, and then we take those nutrients, the macronutrients, what are our three nutrients that give us energy? Fat, protein, and carbohydrate. Those are broken down to release energy, to give our body energy, to move your hand, move your mouth, blink your eyes, have your heartbeat. There are, you know, obviously numerous functions in our body that need continuous energy. And that's where our macronutrients come into play. The micronutrients, the B vitamins, they don't actually give us energy. And you'll be asked that on your exam. Do B vitamins give you energy? They don't. You don't break them down to release energy. But they're involved in that process of breaking down those carbohydrates to release energy, or the fatty acids to release energy. The B vitamins are involved in that process and necessary for it because they act as the coenzymes. So we're going to start with vitamin B1, which is thiamin. Now, why is it B1? Because it was discovered first. And you'll go through and see all the different type of vitamin B vitamins, and it was in the order that they were discovered. So thiamin functions in energy metabolism, and that's assisting in the metabolism of carbohydrates, amino acids, which are the building blocks for proteins, and fatty acids. Now, what if you don't get enough thiamin? Well, that causes a condition called beriberi, and there are actually numerous types of beriberi, but in general, because thiamin is so important for both the nerves and the brain, because they require a lot of energy, these symptoms that are seen involve both the nerves and the brain. So loss of sensation in the hands and the feet, a weakness, even advancing paralysis. And as you can see here, this gentleman is requiring crutches to get by and is unable to lift his feet up. We don't see this much in the United States because thiamine, it's widespread in food, and so it's really easy to obtain enough to prevent deficiency. So lentils, brown rice, wheat germ, spinach, and then some of the meat sources, animal sources, are pork. It is fortified in a lot of foods, which is another reason we don't see deficiency. But again, any food that's going to be fortified is a processed grain, and I'm not recommending that you increase your intake of processed grains. So I'd like you to stick with whole food sources for all your nutrients. So vitamin B2, this is riboflavin. Riboflavin also involved in energy metabolism. Deficiency will It's very generalized just because it's involved in the energy metabolism for all cells. So you see the mouth cracks and rashes, a red tongue called a magenta tongue. Again, we don't see this that often. Riboflavin naturally occurs in milk, yogurt, and then you also find it in grains. So again, we don't see a lot of riboflavin deficiency. I do want to specifically point out about riboflavin that it is destroyed by UV light. And because one of the main sources that we obtain our riboflavin is from milk, we don't want, if that's exposed to light, it's going to be destroyed. So have you ever noticed that all of the milk comes in these opaque cartons or these cardboard cartons? Well, this is so the UV light won't destroy riboflavin. Right? We're seeing kind of a resurgence of this glass container, but it has to be a UV protected glass in order for them to sell it so as not to destroy riboflavin. Vitamin B3 is niacin. Niacin also involved in energy metabolism, and deficiency results in what's called pellagra. We call it kind of the four D's because niacin deficiency will affect skin structures and the digestive tract. So there's diarrhea, dermatitis, which is, you can see here, the skin condition, dermatitis, dementia, and even death, which can be associated with niacin deficiency. I do want to point out that niacin is also used for controlling blood lipids. So when you think about someone having a high cholesterol, so maybe their LDL is high and their HDL is low. Well, niacin has in the past been used for that. But I do want to point out that new research has shown that it's not as effective as some of the other drugs, so it's not being used as often. When you have too much niacin, or you're taking niacin in a pill form, so in a supplement form, particularly to control blood lipids, one of the main problems that is seen is what's called a niacin flush. Because niacin will actually open up the blood vessels and the face becomes really red or flushed. And if someone's taking niacin, they really shouldn't drink alcohol with it. If you've ever seen anyone do that, and I have, you know, these big welts will form on the chin and the face. And it's people usually make that mistake one time because it's so uncomfortable. So food sources. Niacin, notice how the main food sources of niacin are animal foods. So we have the chicken and pork and beef and tuna, although you will find it in some plant foods. Potatoes is one example. Pyridoxine, which is vitamin B6, is actually, although it does have some role in energy metabolism, it actually has just a diverse range of functions. It's involved in over 100 different reactions, mainly as a coenzyme. And some of the main functions are an amino acid conversion, releasing stored glucose, immune function, and even brain development. But that's just a small part of the list. I want you to know that I'm not holding you accountable for knowing all the functions of B6. Just know that it's very diverse and is involved in many reactions in the body. Now, because it's involved in so many reactions in the body, the deficiency will result in these very general symptoms of weakness and fatigue and depression. You can get an anemia, irritability, insomnia, so very general symptoms. Vitamin B6 toxicity is not common from food. It can occur with supplementation, though. If you go to the store and start looking at some of those complex B vitamins and Super B, what you're going to find is some of those have 1,000, 2,000, 5,000 times the recommended dietary allowance. And you really do have to be careful because there have been reported vitamin B6 toxicity. So where does B6 come in? You're going to see the same theme, these animal sources such as turkey and pork. Beef liver, and you know, most people don't eat beef liver these days, but some plant sources as well, such as bananas and spinach. Vitamin B9, so this is folate, and folate, and this is the one I want you to know specifically, that is involved in new cell synthesis. synthesis of DNA and of amino acids. This is really important because if there's a folate deficiency during an early part of pregnancy, then something called a neural tube defect, the most common form of a neural tube defect is spina bifida, will develop. And that's because the neural tube, we think this is just our, our spinal cord here in the vertebrae, the neural tube develops within those first few weeks of life. And if you think about it, most women don't know they're pregnant those first few weeks. It's afterwards. And that's when the main development occurs. If there's not enough folate, then what's called spina bifida is that this neural tube to protect the spinal cord doesn't develop and it ends up pouching out. So this is a spinal cord coming out of the back. And I can tell you, I see and treat some patients with spinal bifida, and it's a real range of symptoms from being in a wheelchair when they're older where they can't walk to just using a cane and having difficulty with walking, so a weakness as opposed to paralysis. But it's a preventable condition. Fortification of folate of our grain products started in about the mid-1990s. And this graph represents the incidence of neural tube defects. And you can see we have a rising incidence. And when fortification started, soon after that, there was a decreasing incidence. And the idea is that you need to fortify with folate because people are becoming pregnant without knowing it, and once they find out, taking the folate isn't going to help. So if you are in your childbearing years, you actually might find that your OB might actually recommend that you supplement with folate just to make sure, although you can get all the folate you need from food. So where are those food sources? Well, we tend to think of folate, foliage, so spinach and dark leafy greens, but again, we're going to see lentils and asparagus, avocado, and again, you can see the beef liver continues to pop up. Not that many people are eating beef liver these days. And again, like our legumes, so lentils and beans, pinto beans. We're going to finish up with vitamin B12. And vitamin B12 also has kind of a distinctive function, and that's maintaining nerve sheaths, protecting nerves. It's very important in hemoglobin synthesis, and hemoglobin, remember, that's what carries oxygen in the bloodstream. That's part of our red blood cells. So when there's a deficiency of B12, you're going to see an anemia. Now, most people think of anemia as an iron deficiency anemia, but this is separate. It's not associated with iron. This is a B12 deficiency because B12 is necessary for the formation of hemoglobin. So you'll develop that pernicious anemia, so it's a different type of anemia. The B12 deficiency will also result in problems with the nerves, and that's going to be a numbness, tingling, paresthesias, weird sensations. It's going to be in the hands and the feet, and actually I see this as a podiatrist, I actually see this quite often. Well, I should say as far as all the neuropathies goes, or the loss of sensation in individuals' feet and legs, B12 ends up being a fairly common problem associated with that, or a common cause. Diabetes is the most common cause, of course, but B12 deficiency is also another cause. And what that results in for individuals is that they can't feel their feet. That means they develop open sores on their feet, and they walk around on the open sores. That increases the chance of infection and even amputation. So B12 deficiency is not something that you want. The reasons people will develop a B12 deficiency is, one, not getting enough B12 from food sources, and that's mostly with vegans, and because B12 only occurs in animal foods. The elderly as well will have a problem with B12, but not because they're not getting it from food. Instead, it's because they can't absorb it. And here's why. B12 requires something called intrinsic factor and to be absorbed. Now, when B12 is usually taken and is bound to a protein, the acidity in the stomach will actually release it. Intrinsic factor is then released from the stomach, and it binds to B12, and then once it gets to the intestines, it's then absorbed into the bloodstream. When, as individuals get older, they have atrophy of their stomach lining, they have problems maintaining the acidity, and they also have problems forming intrinsic factor. So they might be obtaining enough B12, but they're not absorbing enough B12. When this occurs, that's when individuals get B12 injections, because taking it by mouth, they're not going to have a high absorption rate. So again, my emphasis on the food sources for B12, it only occurs in animal foods. We've got crabs and there's some other seafood that has B12, pork and tuna, cheese, beef. See, this is all going to be animal sources. For individuals who are vegan, and vegans don't eat any animal products at all, they really do have to rely on supplements or fortified sources such as nutritional yeast in order to obtain enough B12. So again, if I ask you on an exam who is at risk for pernicious anemia, it's the elderly who are actually most at risk. And the reason is, even though vegans are also at risk, most vegans are fairly educated on what they need to supplement, what they're not getting, what nutrients they're not getting from their diet. And B12 is only found in animal sources. Lastly, I just want to mention that B12 and B6 actually work together. They depend on each other for activation. And I also have folate in here as well. So we have vitamin B12 and B6 depending on each other for activation, but then folate is also works with B12 and B6. And what you'll find when you go to the store and you look at a supplement, you'll see a lot of vitamin B complexes as opposed to, say, just B12 or B6. I mean, you will find those, but it is because we do need those vitamins, not in isolation, but to work together. So if you have, one of these vitamin supplements you're taking and having in abundance, what you'll end up with is, overshadowing potentially a deficiency of another of the B vitamins. And that is the end of all of our lecture material on B vitamins, and particularly this one, the B vitamins.